Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ana Vallejo. I'm the Communications Manager of Myeloma Patients Europe, and I will moderate this webinar today. I would like to welcome you all to this online session on personalized medicine in myeloma, and I would like also to thank you for joining us today. For your information, this webinar will be fully recorded and uploaded to Myeloma Patients Europe website, which is www.mpeeurope.org, and also to the MPE YouTube channel. So it will be available in case you would like to share it with someone or to watch it again. Before we start, I would like to make a small summary of the webinar dynamics. As you know, this webinar is scheduled from 6 to 7. So the presentation will last about 40, 45 minutes, and then I will open the session. I will open the session for questions. There are two ways to ask questions to the doctor. One of them is using the microphone in your computer. Just press the right hand button that you will see on your screen, and I will unmute you so you can ask the question to the doctor. And the other possibility is to do that in writing in the question and answer window that you will see also on your screen. I will receive those questions and I will read them so the doctor can answer them. This talk will be given by Dr. Annemiek Royil, Department of Hematology, Erasmus MC Cancer Institute in Rotterdam, the Netherlands. So Dr. Royil, on behalf of Myeloma Patients Europe, I would like to thank you for your kind collaboration and also for your time to prepare and also to give this webinar today. Thank you very much, and the floor is yours. You can start whenever you want.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Annemiek Royil. As I said, I'm situated in the Erasmus MC in Rotterdam, treating myeloma patients, doing research, and I will give you some information about myeloma and about personalized medicine. So I will tell you about the diagnosis of multiple myeloma, the variety in the disease, personalized medicine, and also examples of personalized medicine. So to give a short introduction, multiple myeloma is a type of cancer that comes from the plasma cells. A clone of plasma cells arises of gives one M protein, one type of M protein, so an IgA kappa or an IgG lambda, which actually has no useful function, but also, you know, makes gives the problem of a lower other immunoglobulins. That gives problems in kind of infections. As we know that all kinds of multiple myeloma are preceded by a precursor state, MGUS, then a smoldering myeloma, and then multiple myeloma. An MGUS is a situation in which there are still low percentage of plasma cells in the bone marrow, a low M protein, and no myeloma-defining events. In smoldering myeloma, the clone of plasma cells is already larger, giving rise to a higher M protein, but no myeloma-defining events. In a situation in which a patient has myeloma, then there is an M protein, plasma cells in the bone marrow. An important thing is that there are myeloma defining events. So we see that of globally there are 0.8% of all the cancers are myeloma. And we see that around 140,000 people each year get diagnosed with multiple myeloma. The problems in multiple myeloma are mostly bone pain, but also the recurrent infection because of the low immunoglobulin status and the unfunctional M protein. There is sometimes kidney damage and there is fatigue. So the original myeloma defining events in when we started to treat patients with myeloma are when patients had osteolytic lesions, had anemia, hypercalcemia, or renal failure. But there are some other features that also were found to have to predict for soon multiple myeloma that can occur, and that is around 80% within 2 years when patients have an involved versus uninvolved serum free light chain of more than 100, a ratio of more than 100. Have a high plasma cell percentage of more than 60% and more than one focal lesions. These patients were found to have myeloma or to develop the myeloma in around 80% within 2 years. So also this ultra high risk first named smoldering myelomas are now defined as having multiple myeloma and are therefore being treated. So to have the diagnosis of multiple myeloma, there are some blood draws and evaluations that we have to perform. And first of all, we look in the blood draw and the blood laboratory results if there's an M protein, if there's anemia, hypercalcemia, for example. Furthermore, we look at the M protein level and the free light chain levels. We look in the urine for the light chains, and we do a bone marrow test. And this bone marrow test is necessary to give the diagnosis of multiple myeloma. The bone marrow is required for the diagnosis. When there's M protein, we search in the bone marrow for a plasma cell monoclonal plasma cell population. Sometimes it arises also from a plasmacytoma, but most of the time there is a bone marrow in which there is a high percentage of plasma cells, monoclonal plasma cells. We also perform FISH, and FISH is done to look at chromosomal aberrations, which I will talk about a little bit later. And also we perform now extra genetic profiling. This is not done in each center yet, but gives much more extra information about the prognosis of the patient. So to show most of the patients who have a multiple myeloma have a high M protein or have a M protein, there are some patients with multiple myeloma in which the plasma cells do not secrete an M protein. A lot of patients, 60-70%, have anemia. Around 62% have bone lesions, 20% with renal failure, and some patients, like around 10-12%, have hypercalcemia. So myeloma is characterized by showing by being occurred, or the cause of the disease is mostly due to genomic abnormalities. We see that half of the patients are characterized by having a hyperdiploidy, which means that I have an extra chromosome copy of chromosome 3, 5, 7, 9, 11, 15, 19, or 21. So they have to not to be there all, but at least some. And we see that it's of the, not of the even, but of the uneven chromosomes. Then we see that most of the patients, or half of the patients, are characterized by having a translocation. And these translocations always occur with 14q32. So you see the translocation 11-14, translocation 4-14, 14-16, 6-14, and 14-20. Each time an oncogene is attached to a very active point of 14q32, and that gives rise to extra expression of an oncogene, which helps the myeloma cell, the plasma cells, to survive. Some of these are conferring a poor prognosis, especially the translocation 414, the 1416, and the 1420. 1114 translocation is conferred for extra a neutral prognosis. What we now see is that all the patients, or the different patients, are characterized by differences in myeloma characteristics. So one patient have, for example, translocation 414 or other genetic features than the other patient. That is the first thing that we have found. And we have found before that you can subdivide myeloma patients into like 10 subgroups showing different characteristics in their gene profile, for example. And we see that like 20% of the patients have a translocation 414, while also a number of patients, like 15%, have a deletion 17p. So we have the differences between the patients. Then we also see that there are different clones within one myeloma patient, and that is important for something that I will show a little bit later. So the patient will have like maybe 3 or 4 clones with one clone, for example, having a translocation 414 in a low percentage, which is maybe not detected, or different genetic features. So we see already that the translocations in myeloma, they can already be seen in a precursor state. But the further you have the myeloma, the longer you have myeloma, or the more advanced myeloma is, the more problems you see. So at the time that some patients have a plasma cell leukemia, which is really an end stage, or sometimes also occurs in a primary setting, but most of the time it is in an advanced stage, then we said that there are multiple, there could be more translocation, there could be a translocation and a deletion 17p, there could also be 1q gain, which is an extra copy of a short arm of chromosome 1, and there can be acquired mutations, and very known mutations are from the KRAS and RAS genes. What we also now know, and that makes it even more difficult, is that there was this research that has been done before, and multiple, three or more sites were punctured, and bone marrow cells were analyzed, and we saw that at different sites the clones can be different. So at one point, one site, there can be a clone showing the different genetics than another clone. That makes also the treatment of the disease very different, very difficult. What we have seen that in the state of the MGUS that you can see some clones, some different clones already. Then there will be, in one way or the other, due to microenvironment changes, one small clone that develops into a myeloma. This myeloma is then be will then be treated with chemotherapy, and three things can then occur. You see in the part C that, for example, even a precursor clone that was already there in the MGUS state but didn't grow out to a myeloma can have the chance by, for example, getting rid of the other clone to grow out to the myeloma. On the other hand, you can also see that myeloma that has been treated, there's some still some cells left that are not attacked by the chemotherapy that grow out again to be the myeloma. And one of the clones that is by being treated, a small clone when it was myeloma, but also has a chance to grow out to a myeloma when the disease is treated in the first place, so in the newly diagnosed setting. So three of those situations can occur. And a very nice research has been done in the past in one patient who had multiple bone marrow punctions each time that the disease occurs. So that you can see in the more left side of the picture, this circle with different colors reflecting different clones. So the largest clone of 72% is a clone with certain genetics, certain characteristics. The patient is treated with lenalidomide dexamethasone. Then the disease redevelops again. Then you see that another clone comes up, and that is the green clone of 64%. This is another clone with different genetics. Then another treatment is given. In this case, it was carfilzomib. That gets rid of the green clone, but an orange clone comes up with different genetics again. And so you see, based on the different chemotherapies that you give, that different clones can come up and different clones are sensitive to treatment. And this is one of the examples. You see that this patient had like four clones at start of the treatment. We also know that in more advanced disease there are more clones, and in more in the early stage of myeloma, sometimes only one or two clones, or maybe one clone can be seen. So it also depends on when treatment is started, if this is already an advanced myeloma, or it was a myeloma which is already conferred with a poor prognosis, sometimes based on having the deletion 17B, which is also correlated with having multiple clones already at diagnosis. So the translocation for 14, as I already said, is one of the chromosomal aberrations that is conferring for a more poor prognosis, and that is also shown in the left picture. So the blue line, the patients having the translocation for 14, they develop earlier, they earlier succumb to the disease than the patients without the translocation for 14. Also on the right side, you can see patients with the deletion 17p have a poor prognosis than patients that don't have the deletion 17p, that's the red line. So what is shown already by all these researches is that we can see that multiple myeloma is really an heterogeneous disease. It varies between patients, it varies between locations in the body, and it varies over time and also due to chemotherapy. So what can we do with this information? We always and still actually do treat the patient with the same therapy, so all the patients actually get in the first line kind of the same therapy. In our country, for example, in the Netherlands, but in most other countries, VTD, bortezomib, telamide, dexamethasone, is an induction therapy for younger patients, so patients that are eligible for an high-dose melphalan stem cell transplantation. So we give every patient the same treatment. And that doesn't help every patient. So we see already, of course, that some patients respond to treatment and some do not. And most of the time, we do not really know what was different about this patient than the other patient. We have, happily, we have many new agents that can be used in the treatment of myeloma. We have the IMiDs, the immunomodulatory agents, thalidomide, lenalidomide, and pomalidomide. We have the proteasome inhibitors, bortezomib, carfilzomib, ixazomib. Monoclonal antibodies, one of the latest developments, already now known for a couple of years, and also being implemented in standard treatments, daratumumab, elotuzumab, and we have the alkylators that are still very important in the treatment of myeloma, melphalan, for example, and cyclophosphamide. So what we actually want to do in the future is to go towards personalized medicine. We want to tailor therapy to have the patients get the best response, achieve the best response, and also give a safe therapy. And also to keep on giving a good quality of life to the patient. We have now all kinds of features to look at the patient, to look at the characteristics, for example, to look at genomics, the gene expression, but also the protein expression, and all kinds of plasma cell features that confer for prognosis. And with this kind of biomarker signature, looking at the gene expression profiling, we develop an algorithm which could help in looking at the characteristic of the patients of the myeloma, maybe in the future also of the environment in which the myeloma is growing, to see the difference between the patients and to treat according to that difference. What do we already have now? What do we already use now to treat patients based on their characteristics? Well, we have the high risk multiple myeloma. I will tell you a little bit more about this. Then we have the minimal residual disease, and we want to implement later on personalized medicine into clinical trials. So high risk myeloma is defined based on different factors. We all know, and it's all still used, the ISS stage. The ISS stage is actually more based on the tumor burden. So the higher the beta 2 microglobulin, which is also a marker for the bulk of the disease of the patient, and also the albumin, which is lower when a patient is quite ill, shows that patients that have a low albumin and especially in high beta 2 microglobulin have a high tumor burden and also have a poor prognosis. We have the translocation for 14 and the lesion 17B that confer for poor prognosis and define high risk myeloma. We have also a combination of the risk stratification of the fish data plus the ISS stage, and also like the gene expression profiling and the mutation status that can be used to cover for to can be used for risk stratification. Also, the age still plays a role, but even more the availability of new agents in the treatment of myeloma, which are not available in each country, in all the countries. So that also plays an important role, unfortunately. The myeloma profiler with the Sky92, this is a high-risk profiler, which identifies patients based on the genetic characteristics of their myeloma plasma cells. So based on a number of genes, 92 genes, which in each have a certain amount that they contribute to the signature, will show whether a patient has a high risk or not. So when they have the Sky92 gene signature positive, it shows eventually what we have seen in a number of studies, that they have a lower progression-free survival and eventually also a lower overall survival. And we have tested that in many many patients. So in the, we have tested that in the newly diagnosed setting, which is the left picture on the top. We have also shown that in the relapse setting. We have shown this in the elderly setting, and also in some different study cohorts. So study cohorts in the States and study cohorts with one agent. So that actually we see that this high-risk signature finds or defines or identifies the myeloma patients with a high risk. But it also shows in this case that it doesn't matter what kind of treatment you get, if you're young or old, if you're newly diagnosed or relapsed, this high risk signature will find the patients with a high risk. And it does not, you know, is not dependent on age or treatment. That is what we have found then. We have further found that the if you combine the high-risk signature with the normal with the ISS stage, if you combine that, then it is the strongest identifier of patients with high risk. So what can we do with that? That I will show a little bit later, what we can do with that. First, I will mention the minimal residual disease, which I think is also known already by many patients. It's mostly used actually in clinical trials, but will also play a very important role in the clinical trials, but also in the future to tailor therapy. We see that there are we have different techniques, so looking at the flow or looking at the genetic the clone. And then you can, with a sensitivity of one cell in 100,000 cells, you can find if there's still myeloma present or not. That sensitivity shows that if you are negative in A, if you are MRD negative, then that confers for a good prognosis. So the goal is now more and more to really get all patients MRD negative, and not only one time, but when you really see a sustained MRD negativity, which means that you have bone marrow after 1 year, 1.5, 2 years, if it stays negative, then it really confers for a good prognosis. So also that can be used in prognosis. So what do we do now with the Sky92 or the translocation status? We still don't know actually what will help the patient with the Sky92 positive risk signature, and also had troubles with finding what helps a patient with a translocation for 14 deletion 7DP. What we do know already with the patients with a translocation for 14 and deletion 17P is that there was one research, one clinical trial that found if you give patients with that chromosomal aberration 2 times the high-dose melphalan and stem cell transplantation, that they have a better prognosis, which could even be comparable to the patients that do not have those chromosomal aberrations. So that was actually one of the first usable features and methods in which we have used the chromosomal aberrations in how we treat patients then differently. The next is that we are looking into clinical trials, how we can better treat those patients. So we know that based on the normal, on what has been done until now, that patients with a SCI 92 positive high risk signature perform poorly. So then it is already found that actually double therapy with bortezomib dexamethasone was once very active, but then we found that triple therapy was more active. Then already we are now in the times that we are giving quadruple therapy with daratumumab and bortezomib, thalidomide and dexamethasone from a trial that found that it was the Cassiopeia, that it was very active. And now even we think that with quadruple therapy, or sorry, penta therapy, that we can even help those patients with a high risk better. So this is a MUC9 trial, which looks at those patients that are high risk. So having the SCI 92 positivity and adverse chromosomal lesions. And those patients will get therapy with daratumumab, cyclophosphamide, bortezomib, lenalidomide, and dexamethasone. So penta therapy to get these patients also into an MRD negative state, and then with high dose melphalan and consolidation cycles, get also these patients into a better prognosis. So this is one of the first ways to, and it will be done more and more, to get extra, more intensive treatment for patients that have a poor prognosis based on their translocation or on their genetic status by the SCI 92 signature. And more trials are now looking in this. One of the other utilities using the characteristics of the plasma cells is, for example, the translocation 1114. I have said before that the translocation 1114 does not really confer for poor prognosis. But what has been found that venetoclax, which is an agent that attacks the patients with who have a high BCL2, low MCL2 ratio, low MCL ratio, have a good response on the venetoclax, and especially the patients with a translocation 1114, who gives this high BCL2 MCL ratio, respond very well on the venetoclax. So this is also a very nice way to use the data of the plasma cells to really give targeted therapy with also better response than the patients that do not have that translocation 1114. So personalized medicine, that will indeed enable the tailored therapy and will actually achieve a high response, but also will give the best treatment to the patient with giving no extra trying to decrease or minimize the collateral damage by giving agents that do not really have a good effect on the myeloma plasma cells. So really find a therapy that will best achieve the best response in this patient. And we use now this genetic information in the different studies to stratify patients. But indeed, we have no, in a clinical practice, no current treatment that we will give the patients when they have certain chromosomal abnormalities, except for what I just stated, the patients with a translocation 414 and the lesion 17B, which in some countries an extra high dose melphalan and stem cell transplantation is offered. Then there are now interesting projects ongoing. And one of these projects is the Horizon 2020. In this project, there are multiple centers involved. The Skyline business, who have developed the SCI 92, University of Turin and Erasmus MSc, the Erasmus School and of Health and Policy and Management, and also the myeloma patients in Europe. And in this project, we will look at the data of the data that we already have, look in the genetic signatures of the patients, and we will look what genetic signature of the patients will do for a myeloma doctor, in a sense of that it could help the myeloma doctor to base his therapy choice on and what would be eventually the best treatment to give. So we will search for new predictive signatures that will help us to define which treatment will help which patient, and even better than what that we have now. So we have the translocation 11-14 that really triggers the myeloma doctor that this patient would be best treated with, for example, venetoclax. This is all still in clinical trials and not outside clinical trials. But in the end, in the future, we will have the patient, we want to have the patient before us, look at their genetic profile, of course, also the patient itself, also the wishes of the patient and the comorbidities, but offer the best treatment based on the genetic characteristics of the myeloma. And we hope to have this predictive signatures of these patients looking at their genetic upmake of their different clones. So there were already quite some efforts done with the SKY92 signature, and this is shown also in this slide, in which we have seen that if you look at the right picture, that patients were treated with vincristine, which is quite an old treatment, adriamycin and dexamethasone, or with bortezomib, adriamycin and dexamethasone. And we see that if you look at the whole picture, that there is a little bit of a difference between when patients were treated versus control with the bortezomib or with the VAT, so the vincristine, adriamycin, or dexamethasone. But especially if you look at the risk state of the patient, then you see that when patients are standard risk, so do not have a SKY92 high risk signature, then it doesn't really matter if you give or bortezomib or vincristine. But if you give a patient with a high risk signature vincristine, adriamycin, dexamethasone, then those patients are really not given the best treatment. Those patients seem to do much better on the bortezomib, adriamycin, dexamethasone. So that would mean that in the future, if you have a patient with this SKY92 high risk signature, that those patients will not get vincristine, adriamycin, dexamethasone, but will get bortezomib, for example. So this is one of the efforts that was done. Other efforts is that we look at a patient that are, for example, treated with, in this case, VMP, bortezomib, melphalan, prednisone, or high-dose melphalan. This was done in a trial that has run in the past years. And we see that the ultra-low-risk patients that get or VMP or high-dose melphalan, they are not too large difference. There are some differences in that they get when they get high-dose melphalan or VMP. And those patients show that the ultra-risk patients are better off not getting the high dose melphalan, but the VMP, which is nice for a lot of patients because, you know, high dose melphalan means an admission to a hospital, means high toxicity. So we rather, and the patients rather go for a treatment in which they can stay at home, come to the outpatient clinic, but are not admitted to hospital. But if you see the high risk patients on the right side, then you see if they are offered only bortezomib, melphalan, prednisone, and not the high-dose melphalan, that are worse off. So those patients that have a high-risk signature should get treatment with high-dose melphalan instead of a VMP. So that really makes very clear that it is necessary to know what is your risk signature in the beginning. Are you better off getting no high-dose melphalan and just bortezomib, melphalan, prednisone in the outpatient clinic, or are you better off getting the more intensive treatment? And that is also what we've seen if you look at treatments like, we all know, the lenalidomide and thalidomide. And what we see, looking at the straight lines and the lines that are, you know, more in dots, then you can see that the MPR patients that get melphalan, prednisone, lenalidomide is the first red line what you can see. And the second one, you see that if patients are it's a little bit of a strange figure because it has colors and it has, you know, the different lines. But what you can see is that the patients that are sky 92 high risk, if they are treated with thalidomide, they really have a poor prognosis. If they are treated with lenalidomide, the prognosis is much better. When patients do not have a sky 92 risk signature, so they are low risk, then it does not really matter if they are treated with thalidomide or with lenalidomide. So again, to know the high risk signature, to know the risk, you know that patients should not be treated with thalidomide but should get lenalidomide. So already two of these utilities are now shown. First of all, the patients with high risk in all kinds of clinical trials show that they have benefit from high dose melphalan instead of getting outpatient clinic therapy with, for example, melphalan, prednisone, and bortezomib. And you can see that with looking at the different IMiDs, the thalidomide and lenalidomide, patients with a high risk signature should get lenalidomide when they have a high risk. So in the future, we hope to have more clear view on what the plasma cell characteristics of the different myeloma patients are. So if you come to the outpatient clinic, already in a newly diagnosed setting, but also in a relapse setting, we have the bone marrow, we look at the genetic upmake of the patients, and we treat based on the genetic signature of this of the patient, and really target the genetic upmake of the myeloma plasma cells, achieving the best response, but also, you know, therefore, hopefully getting also a better quality of life of this patient, not to give treatments that are actually not working, but only giving collateral damage. So that ends actually this talk by actually mentioning that in the future we hope to identify the right treatment for the right patients. And one of the most important thing is that we really characterize the myeloma, but we also characterize the patients and find the best treatment for the best patients. Thank you for your attention. So, if there are any questions, please.
Sorry, can you hear me? I think I was mute.
Yes, well, I can hear you.
Thank you very much for your wonderful explanation about personalized medicine. Now I will open the floor for questions and just quickly remind you that you have two ways to ask questions. One of them is using the microphone in your computer by clicking in the right hand button, and the other way is just send the question in the Q&A window in writing, so I will read the question to the doctor. So if you have any questions, just use one of the of both ways to ask your question. Well, some of you already asked some things, so I will start with the first question. The first question said, is personalized medicine the same as stratified medicine? If not, what is the difference between them?
Well, stratified medicine, we use stratification more when we want to divide the patient into clinical trials to have to be sure that they're equally divided and that we can really evaluate the risk of the patients and the treatment that they get. That is, first of all, targeted therapy or personalized medicine. There are actually multiple ways to say it, but it actually says that you want to, you also have like tailored therapy, targeted therapy. All it says is that you want to know actually the plasma cell characteristics of the myeloma, and to know also the characteristics of the patients, to, you know, really give the right treatment for the right patients. And that can be in different ways. So at least genetic makeup makes sense. The head chromosome aberrations, they make sense to, you know, find the right treatment or to use the right treatment. And on the other hand, personalized medicine also means that you look at the patient yourself to take their wishes into account, but also take the, for if they already had treatment before, to take the comorbidities and the toxicity that they have before into account. So that is really tailored to the patient.
Thank you very much, Doctor. The next question, where could patients get their myeloma genetic test done if the test is not available in their country?
Well, the test, only if the test is available, but that is also by the company that develops the Sky92. They have already with number of centers contact, and for example in England, but also in Italy, I think that there are already centers that have the Sky92 available, but not all centers as yet. And but it is something that we want to roll out further, and that could also indeed be implemented in hopefully in the future clinical practice. Especially because we now see more and more the utility of the chromosomal aberrations, but also of the Sky92 risk signature. So, but not yet in all centers. And if that there is no, if the centers have no connection with Sky, with Skyline, Skyline has not talked to the centers yet, then there is the Sky92 signature is not available yet for those patients. But hopefully in the future, more centers also will use the Sky92 signature or the new developed signatures that that we are all working on.
Thank you very much. The next person would like to ask the question with the microphone. So Jürgen, I'm unmute you, so you can ask your question directly to the doctor.
Hello, this is Jürgen. I'd like to know if Sky92 replaces the FISH test.
That's a really good question. I have showed in one of the, I hope you can still see the slides. I will go back to one of the slides to show something here. In this analysis, we looked at all the available risk factors. So as you can see on the left side, you can see that there's deletion 13q, deletion 70p, translocation 414, ISS stage on its own. And we actually saw that comparing or using all the different prognostic factors, that when you combine the Sky92 signature with ISS, that gives the strongest separation of high-risk patients versus standard-risk patients. But in the end, it will not replace the translocations or the lesion 17P as yet, not at all. That is really, there's more research necessary to see the difference between that. And we have, with some of the clinical data, we have already shown that, for example, I think it was the last study that I showed, I think it's, this study showed This was a study done in elderly patients with melphalan, prednisone, telenilamide, and with lenalidomide, that it was the best way of dividing the patients into a high risk was based on the SCAR92 signature. So I think that both the SCAR92 signature and the FISH data both are necessary for the future. And really the most of the studies and trials that are developed now use both. So the MUC9 trial that I showed used the SCAR92 and FISH data, but some trials only use the FISH data still. So I think in the future it will be both used until we have more and more evidence that we could use one or the other. But I think it will go even further. So we have this now, but in the future, I hope we also have like more predictive signatures that predict if you use a certain treatment, for example, bortezomib or carfilzomib, that you have the signature of the patient that says, okay, I will respond to the carfilzomib, or I will respond better to the lenalidomide. So that goes more towards the predictive signatures, and they are being developed in the coming future.
Okay, thank you. So I understood SCAR92 is not part of a normal diagnostic.
Yes, it's not. In our center, it is. But in most centers, it is not yet. It is we still use the translocation for 14 and deletion 17p because guidelines, as we have now, tell us then to do, for example, a tandem high dose melphalan transplantation. But that will already also change probably in the future, getting more and more data, and it's not standard in the workup of the myeloma patient as yet in the most centers.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Well, next question. Should you do a genetic profiling every time when you have a relapse to see if there is a higher risk than you know before?
Yeah, I think so. To be honest, in practice, we do not do that yet. And that is because we cannot, we don't know as yet that when a patient has a relapse, we do the bone marrow, but not all the time we do the risk signature. And we do not know exactly what the genetic makeup is of the myeloma at relapse. If we have in the future more predictive signatures, then it would be more utility. Then you know when a patient has a relapse, what is the genetic makeup, what should I give the patient now. For now, we base ourselves mostly on what has the patient already had. So we had the patient bortezomib, and was he not responsive on bortezomib, we give not a proteasome inhibitor, but we give an IMiD, like lenalidomide. And we base our choice on, did the patient have neurotoxicity in the beginning? Then we give another agent that does not give neurotoxicity. So, but in the future, would be interesting to do this. But and then it would be really necessary to do a bone marrow each time to tailor the treatment.
Thank you, doctor. Next question. You only showed higher risk along genetic profiles. Are there also other signals of higher risk? Because there are also a lot of differences in the way patients react to therapies.
Yeah, exactly. But that's exactly why we want to look at more the predictive signatures in the future. To find out if the genetic makeups shows that, for example, let's take the translocation 1114. If a patient has a translocation 1114, we will have a high chance that the patient will respond to treatment. So that might help us to choose treatment in the future.
Thank you very much. The next question, are there any difference in the results using the SCAI-92 between M component or line change disease?
No, not between light chain or M protein disease. No differences.
Well, thank you very much. The next questions. Apart from genetics or biological characteristics to test the efficacy of that a drug can have, is the quality of life something explored in this kind of medicine? I mean, are there drugs with less side effects for a specific group of patients compared with other group of patients?
That's a good question, and that is difficult because, for example, if you suppose we take again the example of the translocation 1114, because that is the best example that we have for now, and then you want to actually give venetoclax because that is the most effective. Then one thing you can say is that at least you give treatment on which you know the patients will respond. You don't have to give like other medication, for example, lenalidomide, to which the patient will less likely respond, which also has some side effects. So you can tailor the treatment in that way that you will balance effectivity versus quality of life. But the quality of life is, of course, still that is of major importance. But that is why I said before, indeed, you want to prevent collateral damage because of giving agents that do not actually target the myeloma but will give side effects. So the quality of life plays an important role and the major role. So, for example, if we see that a patient will respond very likely to bortezomib but has neurotoxicity already grade 2 or 3, then of course that will overrule the choice of giving bortezomib to that patient. Then you will search for another carfilzomib or whatever. But so of course the quality of life and toxicity play an important role.
Thank you very much. Next question. What are the barriers to apply personalized medicine in healthcare systems? I think we heard something about access, but not sure if there are other barriers.
Do you mean for the high-risk signature or do you mean for the agents?
I think this person is referring in general. I mean, for example, if you don't have availability of diagnosis text or if you don't have access to the medicine, not sure if there are any other barrier.
Yeah, well, those are the two most important barriers, especially the latter one. So not having the agents available that you would actually want to give to a patient based on their risk status, that is the major problem. And that is something very difficult to attack. The other thing is not having the SCI 92 risk signature. That is also something, you know, most of the countries do have FISH available. That is almost in all countries. And that is also a very important prognostic marker to which we now adjust our therapy. The SCI 92 is one of the markers that we have developed and that we see works good. But we will also in the future look further to all kinds of methods in which we can look at the plasma cell genetic uptake and to use for treatment choice. And in the future, we'll also come across barriers in which the genetic signature has to be of the diagnostic have to be approved by regulations and be available in the different countries. But that is something that I cannot foresee in the future how that will go. But for now, the SCI 92 will hopefully be available in more countries and more centers.
Thank you, doctor. That was the last question. So thank you for this interesting webinar. Just remind you all that this webinar has been recorded and will be available in the MPE website, which is www.mpeeurope.org, and it will be available also in our YouTube channel. Thank you, doctor, and thank you very much for your attention. Have a nice evening.
Thank you. Have a nice evening. Thank you very much.